Hello everyone, Emily Schmidt here, and I'm here to talk to you about country music. Now, before half of you click away, this podcast is for two types of people. Those of you who do like country music, and those of you who don't, but are curious to learn more. Now today, you'll notice I have a special guest with me, Joel Jones, my close friend and classmate. Joel, do you wanna tell me about yourself?
I was born in Houston, so that's like country music territory, but I do not actually terribly enjoy country music, although there are some that I do like. I'm a music major here, gonna be a senior next semester, and my hope is to be a actual music performance professional.
Joel and I both, our relationship with country music is pretty similar. Neither one of us really listen to it outside of this podcast, really, so I'll be berating him with a lot of examples that he so graciously volunteered to be on this podcast, and I appreciate it.
No problem.
So, like I segued last week, at the end of last week's episode, we'll be talking about the slide guitar today. What do you know about the slide guitar?
Not much. I play acoustic guitar, but slide guitar, I don't know much about at all.
Well, first off, the slide guitar technique is actually a pretty popular technique in many different cultures of music. So I'm going to show you a few cultures that have used the slide technique that aren't really related to country music today, but it shows that the slide is a very versatile type of technique. So the first one we have is called the Japanese koto. And you can notice with that one, it wasn't really a slide, it was more of a bend.
Yeah, I enjoy watching Asian martial arts films, and that type of music is commonly heard there.
Yeah, totally. So that was one example. Another example of that bending technique is from the Indian sitar. I'm sure you're familiar with that, what that sounds like.
I've heard of that one before.
Yeah. And that's another one where he bends the string rather than like slides on it.
Oh, so like a slide guitar is where you just slide as you're playing?
Yeah. I'll get into the logistics of it, especially here with this next instrument. This gets closer to where the slide guitar that we see in country music. The origination of it is kind of disputed. Some sources give credit to the West African diddly bow, and a lot of other sources give credit to Joseph Kekuku, the Hawaiian slide guitarist. So first is the diddly bow from West Africa.
Yeah. It's just called steel guitar, where you sat in your lap and you could play it like that.
Yeah.
That's what I mentally classify that as.
Yep, and that is one of the types. So okay. Look at you. You're a natural. It's a steel guitar already. There are many other types that we'll get into later on as well. But yeah, like you said, it is a lot more similar to what we hear like nowadays with the metal on metal sound. And this one actually only has one string. So
a capo.
Yeah, kind of. And then he hits the string to create more tension on it to change the pitch even more too, which is a little bit different than what we see today. The other example that is kind of credited towards influencing modern country music is Joseph Kekuku from Hawaii. This isn't him playing because he was born in 1874 and died in 1932. So that was really at the end of his life was when recorded music was kind of first being introduced. Mm-hmm. So we don't have anything, at least I couldn't find anything directly from him, but this is the traditional Hawaiian steel guitar music that he would have played.
That sounds very familiar.
Yep. Are you a SpongeBob fan?
I have not.
No?
Really watched SpongeBob.
Yeah, I always think of SpongeBob when I hear this. A little bit more about Joseph Kekuku. The legend behind how he created the slide guitar is kind of, it's like an oral tradition, so nobody really knows exactly how. But one source that I saw said that he was walking along and found a railroad spike and was like, oh, that's kind of cool, and put it in his pocket, and then went back home and took his steel guitar out and put it on his lap, and then plucked it, like you said, horizontally, and then slid the railroad spike on it and got a really cool sliding sound. But other people would say that it was the diddly bow that influenced it more. Both could have happened too, right? With all the different cultures that have used that kind of sound, could have been both. So now that I've kind of given you a background as to where the slide guitar came from, I'll play some modern examples for you since, like you admitted, you're not the biggest fan of country music. So I'll give you a little taste of what the specific slide guitar sound that I noticed in country music is.
Heard things like this so often, I think, but I never really considered what kind of guitar that was. I was like, oh yeah, that's part of the aesthetic.
Yeah, you would say that it sounds just like country music.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I always liked slide guitar, I know, in like surf music, which I'll touch on in a couple other examples. So I always knew I was a fan of slide guitar, and that was kind of the question, one of the questions that I had when I was looking in country music. I'm like, well, I like slide guitar. Why don't I like it in country music? Or does that factor into why I'm not the biggest fan? The similarities between all three that I noticed too are they all have a really warm sound, and they all obviously connect different notes together and slide between both chords and melodic lines too, so individual notes. And that actually is a characteristic of what makes country slide sound really distinct, that capability to play both melodic lines and chordal line. So now that you've heard some country slide guitar and also some other cultures who use the slide and bending techniques, I'm going to complicate the slide guitar even more, believe it or not. So like I mentioned earlier with surf rock, the slide guitar is a function in many other genres besides just country music. And one of the most prominent genres is the blues. Do you listen to blues music at all?
I think I listen to R&B, but not necessarily just straight blues.
Yeah.
Not very much.
Have you heard of Muddy Waters?
Possibly.
He's one of the earliest musicians in the blues genre. He actually uses the slide guitar quite often in his music. So definitely very different than what we've heard.
I have listened to Muddy Waters before, just not this one, I think.
Uh-huh. Yeah, he's got a lot of different songs. And this is his later work, too. This is in the 80s, so he was popular before that. If I had to describe the differences between this slide and the other slide, the tone of this is a lot grittier and more edgy than the country slide. Would you agree?
Yes, it's more, I don't know, in some ways the country slide, and sometimes it like blends very well. This is not meant to blend at all. It's like the lead.
Yeah, that's a good point. I never thought of it that way, because this is a solo, and in the other examples that the slide guitars were very much in the background.
And also, at least in this case, it seemed more improvisatory what he was doing, like whatever he wanted.
Yeah.
He could have gone there.
Yeah, and when you're functioning as a background instrument, you kind of have to stay in the chord progression. You can't just go off on your own. And so that was the blues example of slide guitar. I'm sure you've heard this next example, Santo and Johnny's Sleepwalk. If the name doesn't sound familiar, the tune definitely will. And this is one of my first exposures to slide guitar. It's a really beachy feel that I love.
A slide guitar.
Oh yeah. Can you think of any off the top of your head? Or
I also listen to 50s music.
Oh yes.
And it shows up there at times.
Yeah, it does. And that's actually a genre, a time period that I have in here as well.
Oh, 50s, yeah.
Yep. So those are two genres that also use the slide guitar, but in different ways. Like we said, the blues was a lot edgier and more, like you, that was a really good observation, more improvisational. Whereas with the surf, that's again more of a melodic use of it than a chordal or background use like country music. But then, like I referenced before, and as you notice, there are many different types of slide guitar and many different ways to play it as well. So the first one is, like you noticed, is just playing a regular guitar except with a slide on your finger.
Oh,
so and he's wearing picks like you noticed as well. That's a steel guitar. The slide on an acoustic guitar versus an electric guitar versus a steel guitar all sounds very different. And most of the examples that we saw had steel. And then you can also change the material of the slide on your finger too, and that creates a different sound. There are glass. That one looks like it might be plastic. There's metal, glass, plastic, wood. So that's one example. Then, like you notice, there's a lap steel where you can either turn your guitar and set it on your lap, or you can get a specifically lap steel guitar. And finally, there is a lap steel guitar that it's on its own stand, and that's what Santo and Johnny used, where it's like its own box where it's not actually on your lap. And all of these have different functions. So I mean, you're a guitar player, so you know, you just choose however many strings you want to pluck to choose if you want to play a melody or a chordal line,
right?
And then the slide, you just cover all the strings at once, and it whatever strings ring make the sound. Now, a popular lap steel guitar or lap slide guitar player, his name is Alvino Ray. He's known for his talking slide guitar. It sounds like a baby.
It does. That's just what I was thinking.
Yeah. It's crazy. So the last type of slide guitar, I'll just let you hear it and you can describe to me what you hear. It's the pedal steel, which is a little bit different. You're nodding.
Yeah, it sounds familiar, but a little bit different than the classic slide guitar sound.
Oh, you think it sounds different?
I think it sounds slightly more nasal and a little bit less round.
Mm-hmm. Does that sound like a certain type of music to you?
Country.
Yeah. That wasn't a leading question at all.
Yeah, I'm like, oh, it's like they took the sound and like, okay, we want it to be a little more this way. So they tweaked it a little, but yeah. Still very recognizably, you know, slide guitar sound.
Yeah, definitely. In my research about all the slide guitars, I'm like, oh yeah, these are really cool. And then once I got to pedal slide or pedal steel, it's like, whoa, that's country music there.
Yeah.
And as you can see on this clip too, it's called a pedal steel guitar because it has pedals. The pedals bend, when you step on them, they bend individual strings. So you don't have to actually slide on it to change the pitch. You can change chords that way rather than having to like pluck different chords. You can just pluck and slide all the strings and bend one string so you can raise one note and it makes it a different chord. Have you ever seen one of those before?
I haven't. I was thinking of like, if I played that like on a single string on a guitar, I would just like slide my hand or finger up and down, whereas you can just do it with a pedal.
Yeah, and it creates you can be a lot more versatile in the slide too, and with your finger picking, if you don't have to worry about actually using your hands to make that bendy sound.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So now that I've given you a big background on slide guitar and what it is, where it comes from, I'm going to explain to you how it connects to 90s country music today. Now, one of the first country artists who kind of used the slide guitar is Jimmy Rogers. He used it in kind of Depression era, maybe pre-Depression era country music. He's called the father of country music, but he also is credited for influencing blues like a lot. He was influenced by the Hawaiian slide guitar, and he actually included some Hawaiian slide guitar players on some songs of his, but unfortunately he never credited them on his albums. Got a little bit of appropriation there. But I will show you one of his examples to hear how the early country music used slide guitar.
Talk about Hawaii, I didn't know it was so grand.
Did you hear much of the slide guitar in that one?
I did. It took me a second to pick it out. It's a lot, I don't know, in some ways it seems more bare bones than later country. But I could hear, not the slide guitar, just like the music in general. It was all more just like a background for the singing.
Yeah, definitely. And the guitar plucking was just bump, 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 bump. It wasn't any chords or anything.
Right.
And I like this old-timey sound too, because it completely changes the tone of the slide guitar. It sounds a lot more like raspy. Here, yeah. I'll play it again. It definitely has a lower quality to it.
Yes, it does. I can hear it. It's
buzzy.
Like buzzy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So he was one of the earliest, I mean, the father of country music. So if he created country music, the slide guitar has been part of it since the beginning.
Right.
Then I was, in my research, it was really hard to try to connect Jimmy Rogers to 90s country music. And then I've told Joel about this, but I'm actually doing a different project about country music for my English major. I'll be writing eventually a 20-page paper about it, so it's really infiltrated my whole life. And in my research for that, by a miracle, I found just one little passage that connected Jimmy Rogers to 90s country music and actually used some of the same language that I discovered in the previous episode about regular like country guitars. So okay. I was like, wow, this is like the perfect missing puzzle piece that I found. The book that I'm sure I've told you about is called Rednecks, Queers, and Country Music by Nadine Hubbs. It's a great book. I highly recommend it. It's very interesting. But she connected Jimmy Rogers to the honky-tonk country music genre.
Okay.
As, like I said before, country is pretty diverse, so there are a lot of different types of country music.
Mm-hmm. I've heard of the honky-tonk before, yeah. I couldn't tell you how it differentiates from regular country, but I have heard the genre before.
Well, lucky for you, I'm about to tell you. So, the honky-tonk genre, as Nadine Hubbs describes it, it features a lot of heavy pedal steel guitar. Jimmy Rogers started that in the Dust Bowl era. Hank Williams, the first, have you heard him?
I've heard him.
Yeah, and like you mentioned before, 1950s, he was another pretty big honky-tonk artist. Are you familiar?
Not with that particular one, but that's like, to me, I'm like, oh, that's classic 50s slide guitar sound.
Yeah. Then honky-tonk country actually morphed. It fell out of popularity in the 1960s, and the Nashville sound took over. Nadine Hubbs describes the Nashville sound as no more steel guitar and a completely different generic switch, which you will hear. I'm about to play an example from Patsy Cline. Shout out to Diana Anderson, one of the piano professors here. She loves Patsy Cline, and I guess she was actually she played piano in a Patsy Cline cover band when she was younger.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sweet dreams of you.
Thoughts? First impressions?
Yeah, the slide guitar is conspicuously absent.
Yeah.
And another style of classic country. It's just very, got the bass, like almost keeping the beat in the background.
Yep.
And then the singer just wafting over it.
Yeah, so it's interesting that you still identify this as country music, because when I heard it, if I were to just hear this with no context, I would not have described it as country music.
It's also, like, to me, I identify that as well with, and maybe not as much 60s, but definitely 50s music,
mm-hmm.
which I just have an appreciation for, which came out of nowhere.
Oh.
I never would have thought, I was like, oh yeah, uh-huh. I love 50s music. No, it just sort of happened, and then I started listening to more and more, and I'm like, I actually really like this.
Hey, I can relate. Like, maybe that will happen with this. We'll see. I mean, I love this song. I think it's beautiful. And, Hubbs describes the Nashville sound as lots of bass, especially the plucking bass line, as well as she described it as a tinkling piano, which I also heard in this one, which was really pretty in the background. And then, of course, the vocals are much different, too. It's less of that yodely feel, and it's a lot just way more lyrical, completely different. The Nashville sound actually fell out of popularity as well. And in the 1970s, Bakersfield sound took over, and that brought back the pedal steel guitar and the Telecaster guitar, which is what I did the last episode about, which is like the specific, like regular string strum guitar that makes the country music sound.
I'm tired of this dirty old city.
So even with the vocals too, it kind of returns back to what we heard before with the more yodely bluegrass type of influence.
Yeah.
And Merle Haggard is, like I mentioned in the Telecaster guitar episode, he was a big example of the Bakersfield sound. So yeah, that brings us back up to 90s country music, where we started and traveled all the way through the history of country music, basically, to figure out how we got there with the steel guitar, slide guitar.
Wrapped up in a big country bow.
Yeah, big country bow.
You know Reba McEntire?
Yes, I do know Reba.
She has this song that was kind of popular, The Night the Lights Went Out in Georgia.
I don't know that one.
You don't?
Mm-mm.
You should listen to it.
Yeah? No, that's a ballad?
I can't believe I'm giving you a country music recommendation.
I know, who are we?
But you should listen to that one. And you should also try, I think it's Old Red by Blake Shelton.
Blake Shelton. Controversial choice.
I don't know anything about it. Like, is it? Well, like, no, did he just, do something horrible?
No, modern country is pretty disputed. I chose 90s country music because everyone that I know who listens to country music loves 90s country music. Okay. And it's kind of, I wouldn't say universal because I mean people still like it, but in the people that I know who listen to country music, they all kind of write off modern country music. Blake Shelton is one of them, uh-huh, as kind of like sellout, too poppy type,
really?
Of. Yeah. So it's interesting.
Well, I mean, that shows you how much I know about the country music debate.
Hey, that's why we're both here, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And also, Patsy Cline may or may not have done either the original or the cover of this, but it's called The Thunder Rolls.
Okay.
The version that I first heard was by Garth Brooks. It tells a story.
Mm.
It's not necessarily like, say, Neon Moon by Brooks and Dunn. That sort of tells you what's going on with him, but it's not like a story. Whereas those three examples that I gave you, there's like an actual story that progresses to the end.
Yeah, it's interesting that you mentioned that too, because in the project that I did last semester that sparked this whole endeavor, that was one of the things that I mentioned. And both my dad and my friend, Colleen, you know her, they both gave me recommendations, and they both mentioned that you have to like a song with a story to like country music, because the music is pretty complementary of that and simple, so you can focus a lot on the words.
Yeah, that's, to me, that's one of the hallmarks of country music that I do like, is it has a story, and I'm like, well, I want to keep listening to this because I want to find out what happens. Whereas other styles, I'm like, if the music sounds good, I'm like, I can appreciate the music, but I guess for country music, I have to, having the words and the music tied together is something that I enjoy.
Yeah, and there are so many different facets. When I was sitting down to like figure out what parts of country music I wanted to talk about, there are so many different paths that we could take, and that's definitely one,
yes,
that perhaps we could include on a further down the line, once we get past of what makes country music sound like just the sound. We're just focusing on the music right now.
Right.
Yeah. Well, thanks so much for joining me.
Of
I really
course.
Appreciate it. You have fun?
I did too. There were things about country music I didn't know that I found out. Like, for instance, the Patsy Cline example, mm-hmm, that you gave me, I didn't know that that would have been called Nashville style.
Yeah.
But it's one that I like recognize. But yeah, I learned some things.
I'm glad. That's what I was hoping for. I'm glad. Well, thanks again for joining me. Next time on the podcast, we will actually... It's kind of up in the air right now, but I'm looking to continue the saga of what makes country music sound like country music. We so far have covered the Telecaster guitar, which is the regular strummy regular guitar, the slide guitar, which is also a very distinct country music sound to me, and then of course the way that the vocals sound and the way that people use their voice. So we're hoping for the next episode to be about the voice, and hopefully we can get either a speech pathologist or a linguist or maybe even a vocal coach, a country music vocal coach, to tell us a little bit more about that.
That actually would be really interesting. I'd like to hear that as someone who comes from the South and can have a Southern accent.
Yeah, yeah. You can be our linguist from the South. No. So keep an eye out for that one. And thanks for joining me, and thanks for watching this one. Bye.